Shabbat Shalom and welcome to Israel Update. Happy Friday to you. I trust that you're having a good week and that no matter what it is that's going on in your life, I pray that today, right now, as you watch this, you would have a sense of the presence of God and the peace of God upon you. So I'm going to get straight into this. Today, we're looking at the prophet Daniel and I'm going to get straight in. So we're looking at the call of Daniel. So Daniel chapter 1, in the third year of the reign of Jehoiakim, king of Judah, Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, came to Jerusalem and besieged it. And the Lord delivered Jehoiakim, king of Judah, into his hand along with some of the articles from the temple of God. These he carried off to the temple of his God in Babylonia and put in the treasure house of his God. Then it goes on and explains about how the king ordered certain types of men to be brought along that were brilliant and quick to understand and qualified to serve in the king's palace, and how they were to learn the literature and language of Babylon. Verse 6, among these were some from Judah, Daniel, Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah. The chief official gave these new names to Daniel, the name Belteshazzar, to Hananiah Shadrach, to Mishael Meshach, and to Azariah Abednego. Verse 8, but Daniel resolved not to defile himself with the royal food and wine, and he asked the chief official for permission not to defile himself this way. So again, looking here at the call of Daniel, it wasn't even that anything particular happened in terms of, hey, Daniel, this is God, this is what I need you to do. What happened to Daniel is that he was taken out of Israel and sent into captivity in Babylon, which was a completely heathen nation. But immediately we see that Daniel resolves to set himself apart. There's a cutting and a separation where he determines within himself not to be defiled by the Babylonian system that he was captive to. So his call and action were immediately seen together. There was a decision made on his part that said, I am not going to be defiled by the system that I am stuck in. And so the call of God didn't come in the same way as it has to some of the other prophets, where a vision is given immediately or something like that has happened. What it is his call really starts in a place of captivity. And in that place of captivity, we immediately see from the call, the cost kicks in. And Daniel had a lot of cost. First step, I'm not going to be defiled by this. Now, I'm sure that maybe for somebody else, they would have said, oh, well, I'm in Babylon. There's nothing I can do. There's all these delicacies around me. If I'm going to be stuck in captivity, I might as well enjoy myself. Here I am. It's probably what I would have done. I think it's what a lot of us would have done. Say, oh, well, God, look, here I am. You know, look at all the lovely pork everywhere. Here I'm going to just enjoy it because I'm stuck. But Daniel chose immediately to go with a lifestyle of cost. And we see that consistently through the book of Daniel. The part of the cost that we are probably most familiar with is the story of Daniel in the lion's den, where he was thrown into a den of lions for refusing to obey an edict that was given out to the nation, that was said, you're not to pray to anybody except the king, and Daniel refused to obey it. Three times a day, facing Jerusalem with windows open, he got on his knees and he prayed to the God of Israel, and as a result, he was thrown into the den of lions. But we know the account, God miraculously came in. It says that the angel of the Lord closed the lion's mouth and God delivered Daniel out of that place. But that wasn't the only cost that he had to deal with. He also was given visions and dreams that the scriptures tell us terrified him. He had to proclaim things at great risk and danger to himself, because kings like Nebuchadnezzar and Belshazzar weren't exactly the most sane people that were walking upon the earth at the time. One of these here, so we've looked, again, cost, right? We see it immediately. Not to defile himself with the food and the delicacies and the things that surrounded the Babylonian system. The lion's den, we see that as part of the cost. And then seeing visions that terrified him, that too was part of the cost. And here's some of the conflict. This is in Daniel chapter 5. King Belshazzar gave a great banquet for 1,000 of his nobles and drank wine with them. While Belshazzar was drinking his wine, he gave orders to bring in the gold and silver goblets that Nebuchadnezzar, his father, had taken from the temple in Jerusalem, so that the king and his nobles, his wives and his concubines might drink from them. We read about this happening, and then it says this in verse 5. Suddenly the fingers of a human hand appeared and wrote on the plaster of the wall near the lampstand in the royal palace. The king watched the hand as it wrote. His face turned pale and he was so frightened that his knees knocked together and his legs gave way. Then we start reading about this and he's freaking out, wanting to know what happened. And the queen says, there's a captive from Jerusalem and he has the spirit of the gods upon him. We need to call him. He will be able to explain what the writing means. No pressure for Daniel. Verse 13 of chapter 5. So Daniel was brought before the king, and the king said to him, "Are you Daniel, one of the exiles my father the king brought from Judah? I have heard that the spirit of the gods is in you, and that you have insight, intelligence, and outstanding wisdom. The wise men and enchanters were brought before me to read this writing and tell me what it means, but they could not explain it." And then he says, this is the king still speaking, "Now I have heard that you are able to give interpretations and to solve difficult problems. If you can read this writing and tell me what it means, you will be clothed in purple and have a gold chain placed around your neck, and you will be made the third highest ruler in the kingdom." Now immediately here, I think there's probably going to be some conflict, because Daniel was identified as a captive, as someone that was brought in from exile. He was a slave. And I'm assuming again that the conflict in that moment would have been, he could have said, "Yes, I actually do have the ability to do this. I do. Yes, it is me. I do have the spirit of the gods upon me." Knowing, hey, I could get out of here. Third highest ruler in the kingdom, that sounds pretty good. Instead, this is how he answers in verse 17. Then Daniel answered the king, "You may keep your gifts for yourself and give your rewards to someone else. Nevertheless, I will read the writing for the king and tell him what it means." And then he goes on and speaks, and this is where we found many, many tekel pasin. God has brought has numbered the days of your reign and brought it to an end. You have been weighed on the scales and found wanting. Your kingdom is divided and given to the Medes and the Persians. And so instantly there's conflict here. Does Daniel claim the glory knowing that God has given him the ability to bring interpretation? Or does he reflect immediately and deflect and say, "It's not me, it's God. He's the one who's able to do this, it's not me." And so even in the conflict that he faced, do I take the glory or do I give it back to God? Daniel's life, you can see he was in such a position of humility that at no point did he try and claim anything for himself. It was immediate, his instantaneous reaction was to give everything back to God. Not for a moment caring about trying to exalt himself. And it speaks about how that very night, in verse 30, Belshazzar, king of the Babylonians, was slain, and Darius the Mede took over the kingdom at the age of 62. And so we see there was a moment here where Daniel, in the conflict of trying to maybe get out of the pit of slavery, he had a choice to make, and he made the choice to stay in a place of humility and of obedience to God. Then chapter 6 happens, where the lion's den takes place. And then we see how he's exalted and God's name is exalted. And there's a decree then issued by the king at the time saying everybody has to respect the God of Daniel because of what happened here. And then we see that God gives him more dreams. And this is where we start seeing some of the apocalyptic things that happened that I'm not going to get into. We start seeing all the things that God continues to reveal to Daniel. And then looking a little bit ahead, this is one of my favorite verses in the whole of the book of Daniel, chapter 9, verse 18. It says, "We do not make requests of you because we are righteous, but because of your great mercy." And I quote that all the time when I'm praying. Because we see from the call of Daniel, where it was instantaneous, the call was to be separated and to pay the price of separation in the midst of a hedonistic society where very easily his behavior could have been explained away if he chose to partake in it, to seeing the cost that he paid, having to deal with visions that terrified him, having to go through the lion's den, which I can only imagine the terror that would have accompanied that. Looking at the conflict, do I take the glory, do I give it to God, and making the right decision? And seeing his heart status and posture maintained constantly as, "God, it's because of you. It's because of you. All the great things that have happened, it's because of you." And God was able to use him in the most unbelievable ways. And there's still portions of Daniel that we're waiting to see fulfilled today, in this day and age, because of what God did in his life. And that came because of his obedience and his yieldedness. So we look at Daniel and he is a study in the art of obedience. That's what his life is. And again, in the teaching channels here, I'm looking forward to digging in and really getting into the visions and what it is that he saw and what they mean. But for today, what we can glean from this is that the price of obedience is always worth it. Because the obedience that we choose is not going to only affect us, it's going to affect future generations. It's going to affect people yet to be born. So whatever it is you're facing, whatever difficulty you might be facing, whether you feel like you're on the mountain, in the valley, or in that great chasm of the in-between, I pray that the peace of God would be upon you, that his presence would be upon you, and that you would know beyond a shadow of a doubt that he's got you firmly in his hands, and that he is watching over your life, keeping you, and that he will complete the work that he began in you. And I pray that you would be blessed this week in everything that you do. God bless.